so good to be together and worship today, and really moved in this last 10-day window of Good Friday. Services so reverent, so right, so focused on our Lord Jesus Christ. Easter celebrations. By the way, just side note, confetti will fall throughout the service today. Awesome, awesome. Don't shout, but just enjoy that, all right? And we have so much to be thankful for, guys. God's working, he's leading, he's helping, he's strengthening, and we're trusting, and we need him, and we love him. And so it really is sweet to gather together today. We've been blessed over the last 3 weekends to have some guests come and preach. I am grateful to the Lord for Gene Apple and Dave Stone and Chip Ingram. These are men who love the Lord, serve him so faithfully, and they just want to come bless our church. Really thankful to the Lord for that, his word being proclaimed. And now you need to know, you remember we were going through a book. Weren't we going through a book together? Was there a book? Which one was it? Colossians, right. Thank you for reminding me. So we want to actually finish that. And so we're going to, the next 4 of our next 5 weeks are going to be in the book of Colossians. And Lord willing, by the end of May, we're going to be done in Colossians. We're praying right now about what the summer holds and pray with us about that. But one of the weeks in the next 5, Dave Stone will be back with us for Mother's Day. But the main thing is this, that God's word is proclaimed and that we sit under it, that we receive it, that we respond to it. Okay? That's what we're doing today. So I want to pray. And then I want to get into Colossians chapter 3 with us. If you want to start going that way, Colossians 3:15 is where we're going to be in just a minute. Let's all pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for a new day. Thank you for a new opportunity. Thank you for your promises that haven't changed. Thank you for your presence that's available to us. Thank you, Lord, that when we draw near to you, you draw near to us. And so even in this moment, we want to hold your word and hold it as authority over our hearts, our minds, our lives. Lord, let your word be clear. Let it be used for your agenda today. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. 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 All right, so we are into Colossians chapter 3, and since we've had a few weeks off and you might be a little bit out of the rhythm, what were we talking about again? I want to take just a moment and review Colossians chapter 3. And you might remember Colossians 3:1 is a really important verse that kind of turns a corner in Colossians. It says this, if then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Okay? Now I want to put this little summary up here, just sometimes visuals help us, right? If you have been raised with Christ, set your mind, focus your mind, direct your mind, discipline your mind on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. So that was the beginning of Colossians chapter 3. And then he moves in verse 5, I believe. He says, if you are in Christ, if you're a follower of Christ, if you belong to him, some things have to go. The things that came so naturally to you and are totally normal in the flesh apart from Christ are completely inappropriate for the followers of Christ. And so we have this list. Those need to go. Those need to be put to death. Those are not for us. Those are not of him. Those need to be systematically and methodically and repentantly removed from our life, okay? But just like God does, he's not just like, no, 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 no. He's like, and I have something better for you. I have something better for you. Don't just put to death that, but put on this. If you're going to put on something, here's what I have for you as God's chosen ones. I want you to have compassionate hearts. I want you to have kindness. I want you to have humility, meekness, patience, bearing with one another. God's word is so practical. It's so personal. And so we're the followers. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, I don't want to assume that. If you've not yet surrendered to him, I would just say, why not today? He loves you. He's holy, he's righteous, he's the judge, and he is our gracious, forgiving, merciful Savior. But for all who have surrendered to him, this is what we're called to. Now, it's good for you to know, when we work on these sermons, we work as a team. All the different pastors who are preaching this weekend worked together on an outline, and we went back and forth, this point, no, do it like this, and I can show you the text. It's quite a thing. It's great. At the end of the day, we're like, what should we call this? So I would say our pastors have a lot of strengths. Creativity may not be our best one. So we called it this. Do you see it on your sermon notes? Putting on Christ, part 2. All right? So, yeah, hey, this is what you get. This is what you get. All right, so putting on Christ, part two. We're going to start in verse 15. Here's what God's word says. We're going to put these things on together, loved ones, and let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful, and be thankful. I want to give a little summary sentence, and then we're going to get into the text of it here. Just think about this for a second. The followers of Christ are called to a new reality. We're called to a new reality, to represent Jesus' heart and his hands, to reflect his mind and his manner, to welcome his presence and his peace, and to trust his path and his promises. Now, those themes all kind of come out through Colossians, but we're called to something different. God didn't save you just so that you'll be in heaven someday. He saved you that you would give honor to him, that you would glorify him, that you would experience his very presence. And that is where this comes from when we think about putting on Christ and verse 15. Do you see what it says? It says, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. Now, peace of God, the peace of Christ, it kind of has some different realities and some different ways that works out. One of the realities is this. Apart from Christ, until you're saved, until you're forgiven, until you belong to him, you're not a friend of God. Scripture says you're an enemy. Our sins separate us. And so peace, the peace of Christ is truly the peace that allows us to have a right relationship with God. Not because of me, but because of Jesus Christ. So that's one aspect of the peace of Christ. Another way it works is this, peace within me because of Jesus Christ. In a moment, we're going to look at a scripture that reminds us of that. But there is actual, real, tangible, palpable peace that could be a part of my heart and a part of my mind because of Jesus Christ, his presence. And then there's another way this works. So there's peace with God, there's peace within me, but there's one more. Peace with other believers. I look around this church family and I love it. Y'all are different, you know, from each other and from me and me from you. And that's awesome. But how is it that the body of Christ can actually experience peace together? It's because of the peace of Christ. It's because of the peace of Christ in our hearts and in our lives. So we're told to let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. Okay, now rule. What are we saying there? The term is really like this, like an umpire, like a referee, like that's safe or out, or that's a touchdown or a tackle, or that's a catch or a drop. But who knows what's a catch or drop, right? Let's be honest. So to rule means the peace of Christ determines what is accurate. The peace of Christ determines what is real. The rule over my heart, over my mind, needs to be this. I'm going to let the peace of Christ rule. He will determine what's right. He will determine what's wrong. The problem with this is we have a lot of things that want to rule our hearts. Do you know this? There are so many ways we can get off track and get letting other things rule us. It's not okay. I had a problem Friday night. Maybe you've had this problem. It was a good problem. I was home with three of my kids, and Diane was out with one of our other daughters, and we're like, let's watch a movie. Have you done this at your house? Let's watch a movie. What's on Netflix? Okay, well, now we have a problem because I have thoughts about this. My 13-year-old has thoughts about this. My 11-year-old has thoughts about it. My 9-year-old has thoughts. What are the odds we can pick one that I'll think is good and they'll enjoy and that we'll... It was hard. It was really hard. Pray for me. Pray for me, all right? I'm just teasing. Just teasing. It was great. My daughter says, Dad, how about Christopher Robin? I was like, how about a nap? You know? I'm just kidding. I was like, yeah, okay, yeah, let's try it. That was a great movie. I don't do movie reviews, but that was really, we all enjoyed it, and we all kind of commented, like, if we can all enjoy the same movie, that's a pretty good movie. But here's the thing, Christopher Robin is the story of Winnie the Pooh, and if you haven't seen it, I would commend it to you, whatever. I don't get any commissions on this. So the funny thing about that, I kept laughing at the characters, and there's a character in Winnie the Pooh. He's a donkey, he's gray, what's his name? Eeyore, yeah. So Eeyore, he's crazy, man. He
nothing's right in Eeyore's world. And there's this really funny scene. I won't try to recreate it, but he falls into a stream and he's floating down the stream and he's just laying there. And you know, Christopher Robin's like, oh no. He's like, I'm just going with the flow. And then he's like, I'll save you. Well, if you want. You know, and it's just like, it's every answer is like, oh my goodness. He's, I'm headed for the falls. I knew it would end one day. I'm like, Eeyore, what is going on with you? Okay, something was ruling Eeyore's heart, okay? He saw everything in the world through this lens of despair. I can't see it otherwise because it's just all so bad. And when, later in the movie, one of the characters says, boy, this is a cold and rainy day. I wish Eeyore was here to enjoy it. But it's funny in a movie, but the thing is, we all have a lens that we see life through. And sometimes it's despair. Everything's awful. It snowed yesterday. Oh, my goodness. And it was beautiful this morning, you know? So what lens are we looking through? Sometimes we let our anger be the lens. Sometimes we let our foolishness be the lens. Sometimes it's our despair. But what this passage is calling us to, because we've been raised with Christ, because we belong to him, is to let this rule. Let the peace of Christ rule. But I don't like this situation. Okay, let's let the Lord and his presence and his peace determine our direction. Let's let his direction show us our path, okay? Let the peace of Christ rule. And it says this, to which you were indeed called. This is not like if you get time and if you're interested. This is like, this is for you. You were called to this. And by the way, a question, is you singular or you plural? When you use the word you, is it singular or is it plural? Yes, exactly. Both. Okay, so it might be missed in this, but the you throughout this text is plural. So I'm going to use some of my background to help you understand this, okay? I'm a southerner. I don't know if you know that or not. Peoria. So hey, people in Chicago think that is the South. So in the South, a little farther south in Peoria, they say, y'all, right? Y'all coming for lunch? Y'all gonna watch the game? That might be singular, that might be plural. But they have another way to do it, and they say this. They say, all y'all, okay? All y'all. Okay, I just wanna help you use the cultural context here, all right? So all, this is an all y'all. To which indeed you were called, you, all y'all, were called in one body. This is for us, guys. This is not a solo sport. This is a let us together, let the peace of Christ rule. Now, I love God's word, and it's the most important thing you're going to hear today. So I just want to take a moment. I picked a couple of scriptures that talk about peace and the peace God wants to give and offers to give, and I just want to read them. And I have faith to believe there's people in the room right now. Something you're going to hear right now is for you. So listen to it. Lean in, all right? Here's the first one from Numbers chapter 6. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you what? Peace. And then in John, Jesus said this, John 14:27. Listen, Jesus, our Savior, said this. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled. Neither let them be afraid. Here's one more from Jesus a couple chapters later, John 16. I have said these things to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation. There's some promises we don't quote very often, right? There's a promise. But take heart. I have overcome the world. And then I love this, Philippians chapter 4. Rejoice in the Lord always again. I say, rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And then what? The peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. This is for us. All y'all and me need to decide to let the peace of Christ be the arbiter, to be the judge, to be the umpire, to sort things out. I need your perspective, Lord. And the peace of Christ comes through the presence of Christ. Okay?
So at the end of the verse, it says, in one, be, which you were called to, in one body, and be thankful. I don't have any notes on that part, so I'm just going to skip it and keep going. All right. Point two, is this. To be grounded in the word of Christ. To be grounded in the word of Christ. Listen to what verse 16 says. Verse 16 says this. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing who? One another, in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. Okay, here's the point. Be grounded in the word of Christ. Be grounded in the word of Christ. What does it mean to let the word of God, the word of Christ, dwell in us richly? What does that mean? Well, just like the peace of Christ, it's an unbelievable gift. It's an unbelievable gift available to us, but it is not always accessed. The peace of Christ is what he wants to give you, but we do not let it rule. The word of God is what he offers to dwell in us, but we do not access it. And so it's really not that complicated. The question is, am I accessing the treasure that he's given in the word of God? And by the way, this is an all y'all. Okay, this is a everybody together. This is a let's do this together. This isn't just I hope you're reading the Bible. This is we need to let it dwell among us and be in our conversations and be in our communications. Really an important thing. I want to give you three questions on this, okay? Three questions. It's not complicated. It's not a trick, but I want you to think about this for yourself. Here's the first question. Are you in God's word? Are you in God's word? I can tell you in my life, when I have a plan and when I have a place and when I have a priority and an appointment with the Lord, it happens and it's good. When I do not have a plan, when I do not have a place, when I don't make it a priority, it's not going to happen. Am I in the Word? Are you in the Word? Sundays are great, but if the Word is our nourishment and our spiritual food, I don't know about you, I need to eat more than once a week. And so, you need to have this. I need to have this. Am I in God's word? That's the first question. Second question, is God's word in you? There's a difference here. Well, I read it. I checked the thing. I got it done. I did the whatever. Okay, good, good. But is it in you? Is it something you're mulling over? Is it something you're processing? Is it something you're responding to? Is it something you're memorizing? I was thinking about it like this. Y'all have eaten food this week, right? Everybody? Yeah. So, some food is a little bit like a drive-through. I don't have a lot of time or money, and I just got to get something, and I'm going to do this right now, okay? Sometimes it's like that, and that's not evil. Shouldn't do it all the time. And then there's like, I'm going to have a better meal. I'm going to go in a place. I'm going to sit down and eat something better. Great. And then there's this thing called fine dining. You need a reservation. You better wear something nicer than what you're wearing today. You better get there on time and don't rush. It won't be cheap, but it will be good, okay? Now, I think sometimes in my life, I settle too much for the, I gotta hit the drive-through when it comes to God's word dwelling in me. But to set the time aside that says, this is important, and I want to let it dwell in me and nourish me, and I want to cherish what it's saying, just think about that in your own patterns with the word. Is God's word, are you in God's word? Is God's word in you? And then here's the third question. Is God's word dwelling richly in your conversations? In your conversations. Does it come up? Is it a topic of conversation? Is it something you're sharing with other brothers and sisters? I'm not sure what to do about that. What do you think God's word says? Well, I read this week, and it was instructive and helpful to me. We need to have conversations all the time that are full of God's word. Because I'll just tell you, I don't want to offend anybody here, but it does not matter what I think.
and I love all of you, but it doesn't really matter what you think either, in light of what God thinks. We have to be people who are constantly saying, Lord, what do you think? And where you say, Lord, that's not okay, that is not okay. And where you say, that is good, then that is good. And where you say, you'll meet us at the point of our need, then we will trust you to meet us at the point of our need. But our conversations, all of us, all y'all, need to be filled with the Word of God dwelling richly in us. I love Hebrews 4:12 tells us that the Word of God is living and active. Hebrews 4:12, it's living and it's active. That's awesome. Isaiah 55:11 says that it accomplishes the purpose for which it is sent. So even when I don't fully understand, even when I don't quite know how this all sorts out, I can trust that God's word is alive and it's working. And I can trust that it will accomplish the purpose for which God sent it. And I will submit myself to what his word says. But the question is, are we letting it dwell richly within us? And then the scripture says, in all wisdom. I know how it goes. I have these thoughts. I observe something. I listen to someone and I think, oh, I have 5 scriptures for them, and I'm going to go tell them right now. Well, that isn't always in wisdom. Is it loving? Is it time? Is it really what the Lord has for them? Is it my agenda or his agenda? These are all good questions to ask, but we're to teach and admonish one another. By the way, admonish, what that means is to instruct and to correct. You're like, oh, I like that correct part. I'm good at that part. Well, we need to do both. We need to do both because we love each other, okay? But not you're wrong, I'm right. I don't know if we're getting this right. Let's look at this together, okay? That's what needs to be happening. That's what the followers of Christ do. And then the last part of that verse says, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. I am not going to take this opportunity to try to sort that all out. What's a psalm? What's a hymn? What's a spiritual song? Let's settle the age-long worship debates of what type of... Let's not do that here, okay? That's not what this verse is about. What it's saying is this. When the peace of Christ rules, when the word of Christ is dwelling richly in us, the natural response is praise. The natural response is singing of God's goodness, of his grace. I was brought to tears. I'm not a crier, but I was brought to tears several times in worship today. Just to be reminded... You are good, good. You're never gonna let me down. That's awesome. Now, can I sing that on my own? I can try, it won't be great, but I could try, right? Can someone else sing it for me? Sure. There is something so sweet and so precious when the people of God sing together what is true of him. When they lift up their voice and say, even by faith, if I don't feel it, that this is true. And when the peace of Christ is ruling and when the word of God is dwelling richly, that's what happens. So just think about that. I was in my office on Wednesday morning and I had a list of things I was thinking about and a meeting to go to, and I just heard singing down the hall. And I'm like, who is singing? Can you shut the door? That's so annoying. I didn't think that. I didn't actually think that. One of our pastors was singing. And I'm like, man, I know what's on his schedule today. He's got a lot going on. And I don't think that's necessarily because he feels awesome about everything, but I think he was reminding himself of what's true. And me hearing him sing changed my demeanor and my deportment. And we get to do this together, guys. And you have massive influence. We have influence on each other. How are we going to think? How are we going to act? All right. To be grounded in the word of Christ. I'll read it one more time. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. And there's another part there. All right, let's go to point three. Point three says this, to be guided in the name of Christ. Remember, what are we doing? We're putting on Christ. So this means, now this point is this, to be guided by the name of Jesus Christ. Look at verse 17. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus. I want you to think with me for a second. How many things in your life in the last 24 hours or in the last 7 days are outside of that box. Read it again. Whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So you want to make a quick list of what's excluded from that category? Nothing. Everything is to be pleasing to the Lord because I don't belong to me. I belong to him because my life isn't about me. It's about him, okay? And what this scripture is challenging us with is the importance of saying everything, every word, every thought, every interaction, every decision, every interaction should be one that is pleasing to the Lord. If I was going to wear a jersey, it should say Jesus. If I was going to wear a name tag, it should say, hello, my name is follower of Jesus. And if I were to do that, I would have a higher standard, wouldn't you think? Oh, that guy says he belongs to Jesus. Well, I do belong to Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And everything needs to please him. So the Holy Spirit can make the application for you, but everything is for him. I shouldn't have categories of words, categories of behaviors, categories of thoughts that are separate from being pleasing to my Lord. And it's good to inventory this. How is that working out in my work? How's it working out in my work ethic? How about in my marriage? Are you pleased, Lord, with that attitude, with that response? How about the decisions I'm making? What about money? Could you co-sign, Lord, and be excited about everything I did this week? Was it pleasing to you? My hobbies, the media I intake, my thoughts, my actions and my reactions, Lord, they all belong to you. And what God's word says is this, if you're going to put on Christ, which we are doing, and we're doing this together, by the way, whatever you do it in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. It ought to be super obvious that we're his. And I can think of times this week, and we always pick the trivial things, right? But in traffic or engaging with the customer service person where I found myself, there's two ways to go here. You could go one way that might get a result you want, but I don't think that's going to please the Lord. And boy, I just want this so much for us, guys. The Lord has called us together. The Lord has called us to himself. And more than anything, we need to represent his heart, his mind, his manner. We need to be surrendered to him, letting his peace rule our hearts, letting his word dwell richly. Sometimes too many other things are dwelling richly in our mind that we need to replace that with what's true in his word. Putting on Christ means this, by way of review, being governed by his peace, being grounded in his word, being guided by his name. Now, did anybody notice that I sort of skipped a couple parts in the verses today? Is anyone bothered by that? Quick show of hands. I love that you were bothered by that. I did it on purpose, okay? And it's this. Three times in three short verses, the same thing comes up. I think there's something in here for us, okay? I skipped it because I wanted to put it here at the end. And here's our fourth point, to be grateful in everything. Again, could you please explain to me what parts of life are excluded from that category? To be grateful in everything. How can I be grateful in everything? Because I belong to him, because I've been raised with him, because it's his peace ruling my heart, because it's his word dwelling in me, because he's helping me to act in ways that are consistent with his character and loving him. And when that is happening, loved ones, we ought to be thankful people. We need to be thankful people. I joked about the snow, but I was, you know, Diane and I were like, for real? You got to know at our house, don't think less of me. It's okay if you do. Diane does a lot of the shoveling. That's just how it is, okay? And part of it is she really enjoys it. She's good at it. She likes getting outside, getting the exercise. Yesterday she said to me, she goes, Dave, I am not shoveling this. And I was like, noted, no problem. But I got to tell you, whatever that did to your disposition yesterday, maybe something, maybe nothing, I'm driving in today to church, and I'm like, Lord, it is beautiful outside. Thank you, Lord, for your beauty. And thank you, it'll melt, hopefully by dinner, you know? Thankfulness, guys, is a decision. Thankfulness is a decision. I don't always feel like it. Yeah, I'm not feeling it. Oh, okay. Well, then decide it. To be thankful. To be thankful. And to be thankful in every joy. To be thankful in every struggle. To be thankful with every question. To be thankful with every burden and in every season. I heard somebody say the other day, they said, I am seeing God answer prayers in my 50s that I prayed in my 20s. And I'm like, thank you, Lord. That seems like a long time to us that you would wait 3 decades, but in his timing, that was the right time. Thank you, Lord, that you listened to prayer. I talked to someone in the church this morning. The results have been bad. The tests have been hard. I've got a clean bill of health this week. Thank you, Lord. And we have to cultivate this. We have to till this soil. We have to fix our mind on this because it won't always bubble up naturally to be thankful. The scriptures say in verse 15, be thankful. In verse 16, with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And verse 17, giving thanks to God the Father through him. I want you to just take a second, and I want you to gather up in your heart and in your mind, even right now. What are you thankful for? What are you thankful for? And for some of you, you're like, oh my goodness, I need more paper, I need more time, I got a long list. And I got to believe in our church, there's some people like, I don't know. It's hard. It's frustrating. It hurts. I don't know. I got big questions. I got uncertainties. I'm struggling. Okay, we need to choose to be thankful. So I'd like you, even right now, this is the part where you're going to participate, okay? I want you to jot on your notes 1 or 2 or 3 or 5 things that you're thankful for. Just write it down. Thank you, Lord. Yeah, I don't like the struggle, but I'm sure thankful for your presence in it. I don't like the tough ways and the realities we're living in, but I thank you that it's going to end well. I thank you that you never leave us, you never forsake us. Just write it down. If you're not writing notes, write it in your mind. You know, tell the Lord. I want you to take it a step further because remember, this is not a you thing. It's not a y'all thing. It's an all y'all thing, okay? And we ought to be people who are regularly sharing with other people. Can I just tell you what I'm thankful for today? Because there's something so powerful when it goes from my head and my heart to my mouth to my brothers and sisters in Christ, and then it gets returned. There's strength in the body of Christ. So I want you to just take a minute, and you're like, I don't want to do this. It's okay. Just turn to somebody near you and be like, can I just tell you one thing I'm thankful for? I just want to tell you one thing I'm thankful for. Go ahead, find somebody. Tell them. It's good. It's good, guys. I pray that's not the end of that exercise. I pray it's the beginning. I pray that that would spread through our church. I pray that there'd be texts and phone calls and small group discussions. And I got to tell you, I got a lot to be thankful for. Doesn't mean that everything's figured out. Doesn't mean everything's the way I would prefer it to be. But I have a lot to be thankful for. In 1992, I was a college student. And I started my first year at the Moody Bible Institute. Very, very thankful for Moody and its ministry and all that the Lord's done through it. Has many, many strengths. I'm not sure the athletic department is their best strength, but I had the opportunity to play on the basketball team. I think they saw that I was tall or something. So that was a ton of fun. Really enjoyed that. That was a shaping experience, character-wise and relationally. We didn't win very often, but it was fine. And I had this coach. His name's Dan Dunn. In fact, he's still the coach there. And I could just remember different times when we'd get to the end of a practice or get to the end of something, and he would just say, guys, come here. He'd look me in the eye. Don't let anything take the joy of the Lord away from you. I was like, all right, are you done, coach? Because I got to get to the dining hall. We got to, you know. No. Don't let anything take the joy of the Lord away from you. And I was 20 and didn't know much about much. but living some more years and going through some more circumstances, and I can't tell you how many times I think about that. Don't let anything take the joy of the Lord away from you. How is that even possible? Well, it's possible when the peace of Christ rules. It's possible when the Word of God, the Word of Christ, dwells richly in me, in us together. It's possible when we're zealous that everything in every word, in every deed would be pleasing to Him. And it is possible when we decide to give thanks. So we're in this together, guys. It's not y'all, it's all y'all. Let's do this together. Let's trust the Lord. Let's seek the Lord. And He's going to lead. He's never going to let us down. We sang that this morning. Love it. Let's pray together. Lord, You're good. Your steadfast love endures forever. I pray, Lord, You take this word and drive it deep into our hearts and into our minds. I thank You that we can take it with us. I thank You that You've called us to it, and I pray that we would increase our ability to do this together. And it is not about us. It is about Your name, and it is about Your glory. It is about Your fame and about Your honor. It is about Your mission, Lord. It is about lost people who are all around our campuses who need someone to go tell them about Jesus Christ. Would You help us, Lord, to put on Jesus Christ in this day, in this week? Lead us, Lord, we pray. We love You. You're worthy. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen.